I'm Bob Sade, the chair of the Cardiothoracic Ethics Forum, which is a group that is part of both the AATS and the STS. Every year we put together a program at the AATS, STS, Southern annual meetings. And this year, the STS annual meeting debate is on the question of itinerant surgery versus neighborly help, is the way we've titled it. And it's about a problem that's become more prominent in recent years, or at least a potential problem, and that is that more and more thoracic surgeons from major medical centers are being asked to cover thoracic surgical operations at outlying hospitals. We're basing this debate on a specific vignette that's been created specifically for the debate. And the vignette goes something like this. There's a young thoracic surgeon who's experienced but recently moved to a new position in another city. She is asked by one of the older surgeons to cover for him. He has for many years been providing thoracic surgical services for a hospital that's 70 miles away. And what he does is to go to that hospital, do the operations, one or more operations, usually for lung cancer, and then stays overnight, makes rounds the next morning, and returns back to his home institution. He leaves the immediately post-op patients in the care of another surgeon. The other surgeon in this particular case is a general surgeon who has some experience in thoracic surgery. He doesn't do lung surgery, lung cancer surgery, but he does do other thoracic operations. The question is whether this is ethically permissible or not. The question comes up because the American College of Surgeons, in its ethical guidelines, requires that that it's perfectly okay to do this, but when you leave, you have to leave the post-operative patients in the care of someone with credentials equal to yours. In other words, it should be a thoracic surgeon who is left in charge of your patients. In this case, it's not a thoracic surgeon, it's a general surgeon, but he has thoracic surgery experience. That's what the debate is about. The two debaters are Jim Allen, here to my right. Jim is an assistant professor at Harvard and on the staff at the Mass General. And arguing against that is Alberto Ferreres on my left, who is the chairman of the Department of Surgery in Buenos Aires. He also spends a good bit of time at the University of Washington, and most importantly is on the is one of the members of the Ethics Committee of the American College of Surgeons. Presumably he's going to defend the position expressed by the American College of Surgeons. So to start off, I'll ask Jim to present his point of view on this.
Thank you, Dr. Sade. There's a sad truth that there's always a balance between quality of care and access to care. There simply aren't enough thoracic surgeons at major academic medical centers to perform every thoracic surgical procedure. There aren't enough beds to do this. There are not enough nurses to do this. There is not enough equipment to do this. There's not enough OR time to do this. So in order to expand access to care, we have to look at novel ways to go out into the community and identify patient populations that can be served by a thoracic surgeon in their own community and then receive adequate post-operative care to have an outcome that is comparable to the outcome that they would have at a major academic surgical center. Keep in mind that the vast majority of thoracic surgery, even today, is done by non-thoracic surgeons and proceduralists outside of major academic medical centers. Getting an exact handle on those numbers is difficult because there's no single mandatory database to which people have to report all of their procedures. But if you look at the data that we have, it's pretty clear that a thoracic surgeon performing thoracic surgery in an academic medical center is less common than all of the various other options. When considering to operate on a patient in the community, a couple things need to remain the same. The patient's preoperative evaluation should be conducted by the thoracic surgeon. The choice of who to operate on is probably the strongest predictor of outcome. And there are simply some patients in the community that should not be cared for in the community, and there are simply many other patients that can be quite adequately cared for in the community. The second thing is that the thoracic surgeon should do the surgery. I think that goes without saying, but the quality of the surgical operation is a major determinant in the patient's outcome. In my own practice at community hospitals, it's common for me to operate and then to spend the night and to see the patient the following morning and to see the patient again at the end of the day and then to go home and turn my patient's care over to a general surgeon. And this is not just any general surgeon. This is a general surgeon who practiced thoracic surgery independently in his own practice. This is a general surgeon who's an acute care and trauma surgeon. He's capable of opening a chest, he's capable of controlling bleeding, and he's capable of addressing most of the emergencies that are typical in post-op thoracic surgical patients. I'm on call as his backup, approximately 75 miles away, and could respond to the hospital. I do not take other call responsibilities during that time, so that I am available. But the general surgeon's main purpose is not only to function very similar to how a resident would function in a academic medical center under circumstances of routine care, but they're also their purpose is to be the lifeguard, to keep someone alive and make immediate decisions that need to be made at the bedside on those rare instances when that occurs in a timely fashion until I can get to the hospital, which would take a little over an hour. Given the scenario as presented and not knowing all the details of the case, I would support the hypothetical physician providing care in the community because this is a pattern of care that's been established. There are systems in place to ensure that people can be safely cared for, and it's very likely that the patient will get good care, and not only will they get good care, they'll get care where otherwise they might not have gotten any care. So compared to the current standard in the community, the scenario as presented is preferable than the current standard in the community, not deficient in any way. I'll also point out that the American College of Surgeons ethical statement does not require the post-op care be provided by someone of the same qualifications. It simply requires that someone qualified renders the care. So that mandate is a little vague. And I think it's up to the surgeons involved with the care, who all want a good outcome, to decide whether this patient can be safely cared for in this system under the particular circumstances of each individual case. In the community, there's many cases that I won't do in the community because I don't feel, for one reason or another, that we can provide safe care. But I don't think to blanketly outlaw the provision of care in the community is in the patient's best interest or society's best interest. And I'll yield the floor to my colleague.
Yeah. Alberto.
Well, thank you for the invitation. My position will focus in three items. One should be the possibility of complications after lung resection, as in the case of this surgeon who is asked to cover her colleague in a distant, not a remote, but in a distant location. Secondly, from an ethical point of view. And third and last, regarding the requirements, ethical requirements by the ACS regarding the ethical compliance with the terms or with the nomination of Fellow of the American College of Surgeons, issue that has been challenged in the past. From the point of view of the complications, lung resections are not free complication surgery. According to different publications, recent publications, 2015-2017, using the NISQIP data, the incidence of complication is around 10% for minimally invasive procedure and up to 20% for open procedures. So this means that this is a type of procedure that is prone to complications. And whom do you want when a complication arises? The thoracic surgeon who had been responsible for the indication and for the procedure, or just a general surgeon or a kind of a hospitalist or whoever is in town to take care? And the question comes, what if this is your relative? What type of care do you want for your relative? You want the best, probably. From the judicial, from the law point of view, we must remember that professional liability is an issue. It's not only an issue in the US, but all over the world, even in my country, in Argentina, we have criminal and civil litigation. And you are requested to provide not only standard of care, but a continuum of care. And from the legal point of view, the professional liability starts in the pre-op period when you perform the surgical indication, during the operation, and it doesn't end with the operation. It continues through the whole post-operative and recovery until the patient is able to be discharged or able to return back to work. So this is an important point from the legal standpoint of view, that you need to be there. I do not agree. I'm really fear that in the US, which is the first economy, the first nation in the world, you are lacking thoracic surgeons. So some point of view from the point of view of public health should be implemented, or mechanisms to correct the situation, which has been addressed in other parts of the world. From the ethical point of view, there is a category regarding surgical ethics that has to do with the presence. The presence of the surgeons during the whole area of care, as I mentioned, in the preoperative care, in the peroperative care, in the postoperative care. This presence is not only a mandate, a duty, but also an obligation. And this presence of the surgeon is one of the five categories which make surgical ethics such a unique category in the bioethics field, as has been proclaimed by Miles Little, an Australian surgical oncologist. So the surgeon needs to be there, and the patient needs to know that the surgeon is there and not 70 miles away. From the point of view of the ACS, these ethical mandates are for the fellows of the college, and it has to do with the continuum of care and the quality of care, and as Dr. Allen has pointed out, it's a little bit vague, but it applies only for those who want to be fellows of the American College. These bylaws were challenged by a group of surgeons in Nebraska many, many years ago, Dr. Kofoot and his associates, who performed itinerant surgery. And the college was very clear and upfront: if you want to be a fellow of the college, you need to follow the guidelines. If you don't, you will not use the FACS initials after a name, and that means that you are not following the guidelines. So in conclusion, I would like to mention, from a historical point of view, one of the most interesting cases of itinerant surgery, which has to do with the disease and operations of Eva Perón, who was operated not her knowing about this, not even many of her surrounding assistants. She was operated by Dr. George Park, a surgical oncologist and not a GYN doctor from Memorial Sloan Kettering. And 1 month before her death, she was operated in the presidential palace of a frontal lobotomy that was performed by a surgeon who stayed just less than 20 hours in Argentinian soil, and that was Dr. Poppen from Yale University. So my advocate is for the no position in this case.
Okay, we're very close to running out of time, but I think the thing that ought to be clarified is what the American College of Surgeons guideline actually says. Alberto?
It bans itinerant surgery. The only position is that you are able to the person who holds the same qualifications as the surgeon who have performed. So if a thoracic surgeon, very well accredited, performs this operation, the case should be followed by the same level of quality as this professional, and not other.
Jim?
So we have delegated care in the post-operative setting in every practice venue I work at. When I have a patient at Mass General Hospital, one of the major academic centers, we do not have a thoracic surgeon on site in the building. I live 13 miles away as the crow flies from Mass General, and at 8 o'clock in the morning, it can take me 2 hours to get to the hospital. That's similar to many of my colleagues in the division. So we have a system of delegated care both at academic medical centers and in community hospitals that sometimes involves an in-house hospitalist, an in-house surgical resident. In the case of the hospital that I was discussing earlier, the delegate is a board-certified general surgeon who's actually the most qualified delegated help I have in managing post-op patients. I don't think a thoracic surgeon necessarily has a better capability than a general surgeon at managing a wound infection, which is probably our most common complication. I don't know that they're any more facile at managing atrial fibrillation. And in many hospitals, complications like atrial fibrillation are referred to a cardiologist where the surgeon or a member of the surgical team completely abdicates care to a consultant. So I think the concept of delegated care in the postoperative setting is well established. The key factor is what are you delegating and to whom are you delegating it and how closely are you supervising the person that you're delegating to. And those are the things that the attending thoracic surgeon needs to be attentive whenever they're providing care outside of a direct care circumstance.
I'd like to thank Dr. Ferraris and Dr. Allen, and I'm looking forward to the full debate later this afternoon. Thank you both very much.